Welcome to class 9 of 15 days TCS NQT Cracker. Today we will be revising numericals, so I have brought my top 10 questions that I think will help you to revise the numerical section better. So without any further ado, let's start with our today's lesson. So this is our first question. Let us understand the question first, then we will gradually do this question. So let us look into the information that is provided in the question. A number which is successfully divided by 5, 3, 2 gives a remainder of 0, 2 and 1. There is a particular number. If we divide that number by 5, we get a remainder of 0. If we divide that number by 3, we get a remainder of 2. And if we divide that number with 2, we get a remainder 1. So according to this information, let us try to form this number first. What we can write is that if that number is k, we can write 5a plus 0 equal to k. This is our equation number 1. If the assumed number is k, then 5 into a plus 0 is equal to 0. How? 5 is the dividend, a is the quotient, 5 is the divisor, a is the quotient, and 0 is the remainder. So if we multiply 5 with some number and then add the remainder, we are going to get k. So this is our first equation. So first thing that we have done is that we have divided k with 5, so we will get a quotient of a. So the next step, the number will be a, and the equation will become 3p plus 2 equal to a. This is our equation number 2. So again, we have multiplied 3 with p and then added the remainder, and we will get a. And in the last step, the number will become p because we are successively dividing them. So we will get, we can write just 2 into q plus 1 is equal to p. This is our equation number 3. Let us think about this situation first. We have a number k, and if we divide this number by 5, we will get p. And if we divide this number, we are not going to get P, we are going to get A here. So we'll just remove this part. Okay. So if the number is K and if we divide that number by 5, we are going to get A as in quotient. And then we divide A with 3. So we will get another quotient as P. And then we divide P with 2 and we will get the end result as. So this is our full thing. So if we divide K with 5, we will get in remainder 0 and quotient A. Then we take this quotient and divide by 3. So we will get in remainder of 2. And then we take this quotient and divide it by 2. So we will get in remainder 1 and quotient K. So this is our full thing. Now, let us just simplify these equations. What we can do is that we can put equation number 3 or the relationship that is obtained in equation number 3 in equation number 2. So we can write 3. Instead of writing P, we can write 2Q plus 1 plus 2 is equal to A. And if we simplify this equation, 3 into 2, we get 6q plus 3 into 1 plus 2, we will get 5 here. 6q plus 5 is equal to a. This is our equation number 4. Now that we have got the value of a, we can put equation number 4 into equation number 1. So we can write 5 instead of a, we can write 6q plus 5 and plus 0 is equal to k. So we will get 6q, 5 into 6q, we will get 30q plus 25. So it will be not 3q, it is 30q. So silly mistake, don't do silly mistake in the examination. So it is going to cost you the question. So we have here 30q plus 25 is equal to k. So k was our initial number, and the format of k, or the type of k, is k is equal to 30q plus 25. Whatever might be the value for k, this k is in this format. Now that we have this particular format for k, we can try to answer the rest of the question. So what will be the remainder when the same number is divided successively by 2, 3 and 5? So if we divide 30q plus 25 successively by 2, 3 and 5, what will be our remainder? So we can write 30q plus 25 and then we can divide it by 2. So what we know is that if we divide 30q plus 25 by 2, 30q can fully divide it. So we can write this will become 50q with a remainder 0. And 25 divided by 2, this will become 12 with a remainder of 1. So this starting remainder is going to become 1. We can finish the question here only, because only one of the option have 1 as the first remainder. So if this will be an option B only. So this way you can save your time. But no, hold on. We are going to do the rest of the question. So if we divide 30q plus 25 by 2, we are going to get an quotient of 50q plus 12. This is our quotient, and the remainder is going to be 1. So let us divide it by 3. If we divide it by 3, so what do we know? 15 can be divided completely by 3. So we are going to get 5q, and 12 can be completely divided by 3. So we will get 4. If I'm not wrong, we are going to get 4. So remainder is 0. So first 1, then 0. And then at the end of it, we are going to divide this by 5. So if I'm going to divide this by 5, 5q can be completely divided with 5. So this is going to give us 0, and 4 can be divided with 5 with a remainder of 4. So the end remainder is going to be 4. So this is going to be 4. So when we divide this k with 2, we are going to get a remainder of 1. When the quotient resulting from the previous step, and if we divide it by 3, we are going to get 0, and then we are going to get 4. So this is our group of remainder. But if you are confident enough, and if you don't have to check the rest of the question, you can just leave it after this first part. I hope you like my first question. Let us move on to the next question. So this is another interesting question. We can actually do it in multiple different ways, but I'm going to show you the easiest way in which I can do the question. So let us first read the question. The remainder when m plus n is divided by 12 is 8. So m plus n is a number. M plus n is a number. And if we divide this number by 12, we are going to get a remainder of 8. So what I can do is that 12 into some number a plus remainder 8 is going to give us m plus 1. This is the meaning of the first statement. The remainder when m plus n is divided by 12 is 8. This is the mathematical expression of the first statement. And let us name it as equation number 1. Let us go to the next statement. The remainder when m minus n is divided by 12 is 6. I will just remove the marking from the previous question so it is easier for us to understand. So m plus 1, it is marking here. So according to this second equation, we can write 12 into b plus 6 is equal to m minus n. And this is our equation number 2. So now they are asking that if m is greater than n, then what is the remainder when mn is divided by 6? So we have to find the remainder if mn is divided by 6. So let us write the equation, or let us just write the form that we want to find out. So m into n is our number. And let us imagine that if we are dividing mn by 6, so we can write p into 6. P is our quotient and plus x. X is our remainder. So we have to actually find this number. So what we have done? M into n is equal to p into 6 plus x. And we have to find the value for x. P is the quotient and 6 is the number with which we are dividing m into n. I'm not interested in the value for p. I'm interested on the value for x. So let us see how we can actually do this. So the first thing that comes to my mind is that we can see this equation is very symmetric in nature, and this equation is very beautiful. So what we can do is that we can just add this two equation. If we add this two equation, we will get 12 as a common number, and we will get a plus b, and then 8 plus 6, we are going to get 14. And this n and this n will be cancelled. So we will get 2m. Fine. So this is the value for 2m. And we can easily find out the value for m here. If we can take like 2 common from both of this side. So in the next step, we can write 6a plus b plus 7 is equal to m. This is our equation number 3. Fine. And just you can just put the value of m, and then we can find the value of n. We should not do this. What we can do in the next step is that in the first situation, we have added the two values. In the second equation, we can just subtract this two equation. And if we subtract this two equation, we will get the value for n. M plus n minus m minus n is 12a plus 8 minus 12b minus 6. And if we simplify this equation, this m and this n, this m and this m will be cancelled. We are left with 2n equal to 12 to be taken as common. So this is a minus c plus 2. So if we divide this whole thing, we are going to get n is equal to 6a minus a minus b plus 1. There are a few mistakes that I have done, mistakes as in writing the conventions properly. So this is not actually d, this is b. This is just I forgot to write b here. This will be b, and this will be b, and this won't be c, and this will be d. So I will just like slim down the equations. So this will be our b. Fine. So what we have 6 into a plus b plus 7 is equal to m. This is our equation number 3. And n equal to 6a minus b equal to n equal to 6a minus b plus 1. So now this equation is a little bit bigger. We can further simplify or further minify this equation. We can assume that a plus b is equal to our k, some value k, and a minus b is some value t. So we can write equation number 3 as 6k plus 7, and we can write equation number 4 as 60 plus 1. So we have found the value for m. This is the value for m, and this is the value for n. And there is no way in which we can further simplify this particular values. So what we are going to do is that we are going to take the product, or we are going to find the product of the two numbers. What we can do, we can write 6k plus 7 multiplied by 60 plus 1 is equal to m into n. So in the next step, I can write 6k into 60 will give us 36kt, and 6k into 1 is going to give us 6k only. Then 7 into 60 is going to give us 42t, and 7 into 1 is going to give us 7. So we can simplify this equation further. Now let me think if we can simplify or not. We have 36t. So we cannot simplify this equation, but we can apply a trick now. So let us write the equation over here. We can take, or we can write this equation as 6kt plus 6k plus 42t plus 6 plus 1. This is the trick that I'm applying here, and I'm rewriting this equation like this. Once I have wrote the equation like this, let us mark few things. I can take 6 common from here. I can take 6 common from here. I can take 6 common from here. And I can take 6 common from here. But I cannot take 6 common from here. So if we take 6 common from all this initial term, what I can write? I can write 6. I have taken 6 as common. And I can write 6kt plus k plus 7t plus 1. Plus 1 equal to m into n. Now look into this interesting thing. This particular equation is actually in the form of this above equation, where m into n is equal to 6 into p plus x. So I can say that this is the value for p. I'm actually not concerned about an actual value for p. I'm just concerned about the form. So in here, we can actually write or rewrite this equation like this. Like m into n is equal to 6p plus 1. And if we compare with this equation, I can say that p is equal to 6kt plus k plus 7t plus 1. Whatever might be the value for kt, k and t. And x is equal to 1. So the remainder, if we divide the product of m and n is 1. So C is our correct option. This is our final answer. So this question is very interesting question. I find it very interesting. So in the last two questions, we actually didn't find the final value. What we do is that we try to find a particular format and then try to work with it. So now, let us look into the next question and see if we can apply the same logic and we can find an answer to it or not. So there is a number. What is our number? Our number is 2088. A number 2088, by what, if we divide this number, it will become a perfect square. So this question is little bit ambiguous, or I can say this question is little bit badly framed. So they are simply asking us that, What is the number that should be divided with 2088 so that it becomes a perfect square? Fine. So that we can find a perfect square of that particular number. There are options given. We can always do the question by trial and error method, but let us think something. Let us first find the prime factorization of 2088. If we find the prime factorization of 2088, so let us first write this particular number can be divided by 2. So we can write 2 into 104 and 4. 1044 can again be divided by 2. So we can write 2 into 2 into 522. Fine. And then 522 can again be divided by 2. So we can write 2 into 2 into 2 into 2, 6, 1. Fine. And 2, 6, 1 can be divided by 3. How? Because 2 plus 6 plus 1, 2 plus 6 is 8, 8 plus 1 is 9. So all the numbers that can be divided by 3 have the sum of their digits also divided by 3. So 2, 6, 1 will be divided by 3. So we will have 2 into 2 into 2 into 3 into, we will get here 87. So 8 plus 7 is again 15. So it will be divided by 3. So 2 into 2 into 2 into 3 into 3 into 2 and into 9. And 29 is our prime number. So it cannot be further written as the product of prime numbers. So this is our factorization of 2088. Now, if we look into any perfect square number, let us suppose 16. So 16 can be written as 4 into 4. We can look into 36. 36 can be written as 6 into 6. That can be further written as 3 into 2. And 3 into 2. So if you look that, if you look into this particular prime factorization, all the prime factors are occurring in pairs, or all the prime factors are occurring in even numbers. In 16 also, we can write it as 2 into 2 into 2 into 2. So this is one pair and this is one pair. You can take another prime number as an example. I can take 81 as an example. 81 can be written as 9 into 9, and 9 into 9 can be further written as 3 into 3 into 3. So this will be pair and this will be a pair. So now let us come back to the question. So that 2088 to be a perfect square, it should have even numbers or pairs of prime factors, but it does not have pairs of prime factors. This 2 can be a pair, this 2 can be a pair, but 29 and 2, 2 and 29 are odd one out. So what we can write? 2 into 2, this is one pair, and 3 into 3, this is one pair, and we are left with 2 into 29. So by our logic, if we divide 2088 by 2 into 29, 2 into 29, we are going to get our perfect square number. Just give me a second. Okay. So if we divide this thing and divide this thing, we are going to get 2 into 2 into 3 into 3, and this will be a prime, this will be a perfect square. So what is the number we have to divide 2088 with? We have to divide 2088 with 2 into 29. So this is going to give us 58. And this is our final answer. So the answer to it is option number A, that is 58. So again, I haven't done any sort of raw calculations. What I have done, I have based my logic into calculation, and I have found out the correct answer. Now let us go to another interesting question. Fine. First, we will try to understand the question properly. Then we are going to do this question. So it is saying that how many possible ways you can write 1800 as product of 3 positive integers x, y, z. And we have to assume one thing, that x, y, z are distinct in nature. So what? How many total combination or how many different ways I can write 1800 as product of 3 numbers? So what we are going to do is that first we are going to find out the prime factors of 1800. So 1800 can be written as 2 into 900, and 900 can be written as 2 into 3 square into 100 can be written as 5 square into 2 square. Why? 5 square is 25, 2 square is 4, 25 into 4 is 100, 100 into 3 square, 3 square is 9, 100 into 9 is 900, and 900 into 2 is 1800. So we can further write this thing as 2 cube into 3 square into 5 square. Now let us look into one of the ways in which we can express 1800 as the sum of as the product of three numbers. So we can write 1088 as 2 square as x and 2 into 3 square as y. This is x, this is y, and 5 square as z. This is one of the ways in which I can write 1800. So what it will be? It will be like 1800 equal to 4 into 18 into 25. Let me just check. Yes, 25 into 4 is 100. 100 into 18 is 1800. So this is one way where the value for x is 4, value for y is 18, and value for z is 25. This is one of the ways of all the possible combinations we know. So now let us just elaborate on this part of this question. So what we can write as 2 square, I can write as 2 square into 3 to the power 0 into 5 to the power 0. And this is the value for x. Fine. And then we can write 2 to the power 1 into 3 to the power 2 into 5 to the power 0. And this is going to be our value for y. Fine. And then what do we know? 2 to the power 0 into 3 to the power 0 into 5 to the power 2. This is going to be our value for z. So I have expressed each of the numbers in each of the prime factors term. Now that we have this, we can see here it is 2 square, 3 square, and this thing. And what we can see is that this 2 plus 1, 2 plus 1 is going to give us 3, 0 plus 2 is 2, and 0, 0 plus 2 is 2. So the general form in which I can write x as 2 to the power a1, it can be any integral values, into 3 to the power b1, into, then we can write 5 to the power c1. This is the possible form for x. Similarly, we can also write 2 to the power a2 into 3 to the power b2 into 5 to the power c2. This is the possible form for y. And for z, we can write 2 to the power a3 into 3 to the power b3 into and 5 to the power c3. Provided to the constraint of a1 plus a2 plus a3 should be equal to 3, that is this, then b1 plus b2 plus b3 should be equal to 2, that is this thing, and c1 plus c2 plus c3 is equal to 2, that is equal to this thing. So if you look into here, in this first situation, the value for a1 is 2, value for a2 is 1, and value for a3 is 0. And if we add a1 plus a2 plus a3, we are going to get 3. Similarly, value for b1 is 0, value for b2 is 2, value for b3 is 0. So we will get 2, and like c1, c2, and c3, we are going to get 3. So look into this particular format first. Now, let us see what we have to do. We have, let us imagine a scenario. We have A1 and then we have A2 and then we have A3 and we have 3. 3 means we have 3 balls. And I have to distribute these 3 balls into these 3 containers. I can put one ball here, I can put one ball here, and I can put one ball here. This is one way. Or I can just put one ball in one of, I can put one ball, like I can do this thing also. Like two ball here, and then one ball here, and no ball here. This is also in probability. Or I can say this is also in combination. So actually, what we are trying to do, we are trying to put 3 balls in 3 containers. In this situation, we are trying to put 2 balls in 3 containers and 2 balls in 3 containers. So we know a particular equation. What is that particular equation or what is a particular relation? Putting k balls in n distinct containers. Putting k balls and n distinct container is n plus k minus 1 c n minus 1. So what will be this thing? This will be our 3 plus 3 minus 1 c 3 minus 1 and this is 5 c 2. And you can calculate this rest of the thing. This is going to give us 4C2 and this is going to give us 4C2. So the total number of combinations in which this particular solution or this particular question can be solved is 5C2 multiplied by 4C2 multiplied by 4C2. And 5C2 is 10 into 4C2 is 6 and 4C2 is also 6 and 10 into 6 into 6, 10 into 36 and 10 into 36 gives us 360. So our final result is 360. Fine. So this is our final equation. So I hope this question was clear to you. There is another shortcut method of doing this question is. So I'm just mark it in a different color. Please look into this following shortcut and you can comment below if this particular shortcut is applicable to every situation or not. What we can write, we have 2 to the power 3 and then we have 3 to the power 2 and we have 5 to the power 2 and the total number of combinations will be 2 into 3 for this case, then 3 into 2 for this case and 5 into 2 for this case. So this is also going to give us 360. So this is another shortcut. And you can comment below if this particular shortcut is applicable to all the situations or not. So I hope this question was clear to you and I hope I was able to explain this question properly to you. Anyways, so you can rewind this video, go through the questions again, go through this answer again. And if you have any doubt or any problem, you can contact me directly in our Telegram group or you can comment below. And I will try my best to give you a constructive feedback or look into your process and help you to understand this particular question. So now let us go to this next question. What is our next question? It is saying us that find the greatest number that will divide 148, 246 and 623 leaving remainders of 4 and then 6 and then 11. Fine. If this is our situation, let us assume that the greatest number that will be able to divide these three numbers, and after leaving this particular remainder is n. So we can write 148 as a into n plus 4 equal to 148. This equation can be simplified to a into n equal to 144. This is our equation number 1. Similarly, we can write b into n. The quotient can be different, but we know we are trying to divide all the numbers using n only. So we are writing b into n plus remainder is 6 and the value is 246. So the value is b into n is 240. This is our second equation. Similarly, I can write c into n plus 11 equal to 623, and it gives us c into n gives us 612. This is our equation number 3. Now let us summarize what we can learn from this particular 3 equations. We know that n will be factor of 144, n will be factor of 240, and n will be a factor of 612. As because n is a whole number, just replay this theory with me. As because n is a whole number, we can say that n is a factor of 144, n is the factor of 240, and n is a factor of 612. And we are finding the greatest number. So we have to find the greatest factor, or we can find the greatest factor of these three numbers. So simply, this question can be reduced to finding the HCF of 144 plus 240 and 612. We are finding the HCF of 144, 240, and 612. Why n is a factor of 144? Now let us try to find out the highest common factors of each of these numbers. So we can take a shortcut here. I can write 144 as 12 into 12. This is the thing that came into my mind. And 240 can be written as 12 into 2 into 10. And we can see here in this both of the situation, 12 is common. So I have made a legitimate guess the answer will be 12 only. So let us try if 612 can be expressed as the product of 12 or not. So I can write here as 60, like 12 into 51. In all these three number, 12 is common. So 12 is a common factor, and is the 12 is the highest of all the common factors. So HCF of 144, HCF of 250, and 612 is 12. So our end result is 12. So I hope you agree with my thought pattern. And if you have anything to add, or if you have any other way in which we can solve this particular question, please tell me in the comment box below. Let us go to this next question. I have chosen this question due to several reasons. First being, this question or this angle between the clocks is mostly neglected. These questions are very easy to do, and these questions are actually very fast to do. And if you actually learn to do these questions properly, you can expect to get 2 to 3 marks question from this chapter. So do these questions properly. So let us look into the question. So in this question, they are saying us to find the angle between the hour hand and minute hand. Minute hand and hour hand as 5:30. So it is 5:30 in the clock. So 5:30 will be like this. So we have 5 and 6. our hand will be in the middle of 5 and 6, and the minute hand will be over 6. So we have to find the difference between them. So I'm just making this diagram a little bit bigger so we can visualize the things that we are going to do up here. We have 5 and we have 6. So this is our minute hand, and little bit smaller is our hour hand. And but hour hand will not be at 5, it will be like in the middle of 6 and 5. So I will just remove this and then write the question again. So we have 6 and the hour hand will be in this particular position. Fine. We have to find this angle. How we can find this angle? We have 12 here. Let us mark it with some other color. Let us take this as relative position. So we can find an angle traversed by the minute hand up till this thing. And then again, we can find the distance traveled by, or the angle traveled by the hour hand. Like this. So let this be angle 1 and let this be angle 2. So the final angle will be A1 minus A2 mod of A1 minus A2. Given that maybe A1 is greater than A2 or A2 is greater than A1. So that is why we are not sure, like in some cases A1 will be greater, in some cases A2 will be greater. So I have given a mod symbol here. Fine. So what will be A1? A1 is the angle covered by the minute hand. So minute hand has covered 30 minutes, and minute hand covers 360 by 30 degree. No, 360 by 60 degree every minute. So let us revise what I have done here. Minute hand has covered 30 minutes, and every minute, minute hand covers this much angle, that is 360 divided by 6. So we can write this as 30 into 0, 0 cancel, it is 6. So this is 180 degree. This is our equation number 1. Now let us go to angle number 2. Angle number 2 is the distance covered by the hour hand. So what is the distance? Hour hand has already covered your 5 hours, and with it, it has covered half an hour. Fine. As because it is 5:30, so hour hand has covered 5 hours and half an hour extra. So if we write it in this mixed fraction format, or we can just like add it, we will have 11 by 2 hours. So the hour hand has covered 11 by 2 hours, and we know our hand covers 360 degree in 12 hours. So every hour it is covering an angle of 360 degree divided by 12, and if we simplify this one, 11 by 2, 360 by 12 gives us 15. No, this gives us 30, if I'm not wrong. Yes, this gives us 30. This gives us 30, and 2 into 30, 2 divided by 15, so we get 165 degree. So this is our equation number 2. So now let us look into this equation first, or equation here. So the final angle is mod of A1 minus A2. What is A1? A1 is 180 degree, minus 165 degree. So the final result is 15 degree. So the initial angle between the minute hand and the hour hand is 15 degree. So this is our final answer. Let us go to the next question. It is a question for clocks again. So a famous church in the city of XYZ, so these are the useless information, so I can just cut off this equation. I don't need to know how many years old the clock is, like where it is located. This is not related to the question, so I will just cut it off. Now, every Monday 10 a.m., this is an important information. Every Monday at 10 a.m., the clock is set by ABC. Doing a service in the church, so this is again useless. The clock loses 6 minutes every hour. What will be the actual time when the faulty clock shows 3 p.m. on Friday? So this clock in question is losing 6 minutes every hour. So the clock is actually slowing down. So now let us first count the number of hours that have elapsed since the clock was last set. That the clock would be set, or the clock is set at Monday 10 a.m. Fine. The clock is set as Monday 10 a.m. 24 hours. Then we reach at Tuesday 10 a.m. Then another 24 hours. So we reach at Wednesday 10 a.m. Another 24 hours. We reach at Thursday 10 a.m. Another 24 hours. We reach at Friday 10 a.m. And like 10 a.m. And another 5 hours, we reach at Friday 3 p.m. So now let us see how many hours have passed. 24 plus 24 plus 24 plus 24 plus 5. So it gives us 101 hours. So total 101 hours have elapsed, and every hour the clock is losing 6 minutes. So overall the clock has lost 606 minutes. If the clock has lost 606 minutes, that is somehow equal to 10 hours and 1 by 10 minutes. Now let us think, what will be the actual time? When will be the actual time when it shows 3 p.m. on Friday? When it shows 3 p.m. on Friday. So the clock is actually slower. The clock is actually slower. That means it's running fast. But the actual time is more than 3 p.m. on Friday. The actual time is more than 3 p.m. on Friday. The clock is running behind. So all the options related to Friday are gone, because it is like we are running slow. Now we'll come to this thing. How many hours it is faster? We can see that 1 by 10 minutes or 1 by 10 hours is actually 6 minutes. So 10 full hours and 6 minutes slower. So the actual time is 10 hours 6 minutes ahead of 3 p.m. on Friday. So this will be 1 and 6. So this will be our final answer. This is eliminated. This is our correct option. Fine. I hope this kind of question was clear to you. Now let us go a similar question. What it is saying? A clock loses 1% time during the first week, gains 2% time during the next 1 week. If the clock was set right at 12 noon on Sunday, what will be the time exactly that the clock will show 14 days from the time it was set right. So the clock is losing 1% time in the first week, and it gains 2% of time in the next 1 week. Now the question is 1% of what? In the last questions, we have seen that it is losing some minutes or it is losing some hours. Now it is saying that it is losing 1% of time. It is losing 2% of time. So 1% of what? So according to this question, whatever time that we get on the first week, it is losing 1% of that time. Then in the next week, whatever time we have, it is gaining 2% on it. So now let us check how many hours are there in first week. So we have 24 hours in 1 day, and 1 week means 7 days. So we have total 168 hours. That means in the first week, it has lost 1% of 168 hours. So 1% of 168 hour is 1.68 hours. And as because the clock has lost it, I can say this is minus 1.68. Now, let us go to the next week. Fine. In the next week, it has gained 2%. If 1% is 1.68, 2% will be plus 1.68 into 2. That is, whatever it may, I'm not calculating it. Fine. This is the gain and this is the loss. We can find the overall gain or loss. How we can find? If we add these two things. So we can write 1.68 into 2 minus 1.68. So overall, it gives us 1.68. And as because it is positive in nature, so the clock has ultimately gained 1.68 hours. So now let us think. 1.68 hours means 1.68 hours means what we have 1.68 hours means, like, it will be 1 hour 40 minutes and 48 seconds. Now let us look into the next question. If the clock was set right at 12 noon on Sunday, what will be the time exactly that the clock will show 14 days? 14 days means 2 weeks from the time it was set right. So the clock is actually faster. The clock is faster. So from 14 days, like 12 noon to 12 noon is 14 days. So when it will be 12 noon after 14 days, the clock is actually running faster, and running faster by 1 hour 40 minutes and 48 seconds. So if we add 1 hour 40 minutes and 48 seconds after 12 noon, we are going to get this thing, 1 p.m. 40 minutes and 48 second p.m. So this is our final answer. So I hope this question was clear to you. Now let us go to this next question. This is a question for solution. Okay. So I am giving you a little bit of time. Look into the question, understand the question properly. Then I'm going to do this question. Just give me a second. I will just drink some water and we can continue with our question. Okay. So we are working with solution and I had to drink water. So anyways, so how many liters of 90% of concentrated acid? What we have? We have 90% concentrated acid needs to be mixed with 75% solution of concentrated acid to get a 30 liter solution of 78% concentrated acid. 30 liter of 78% concentrated acid. So how much acid is there in 30 liter solution? So we have 30 liter into 78% of the 30 liter is acid. So what we have is 30 into 78 by 100. Fine. This is our equation number one. We are not going to simplify or we are not going to calculate this. So let us assume this is A and this is B. And what do we know? We are mixing some quantity A and with B and we are getting 30 liter. And we have to find the amount of 90% concentrated acid. 90% of concentrated acid. So let it be A. So B will be 30 minus A. So now we are mixing 30 minus A quantity of this 75% solution and A quantity of 90% solution. So let us see how is it going to work. We have A, we are mixing A and it contains 90% of acid. And we are mixing it with 30 minus A into 75 into 100. Fine. Equal to, this is going to give us 30 into 78 minus 100. That is our resultant concentration. So this is the concentration or this is the amount of acid we are getting from 90% concentrated solution. This is the amount of acid we are getting from 75% concentrated solution. And this is our final concentration. So what we can do is that, let us look into the simplification right now. The framing of the equation is done and the rest of the part is to simplify this thing and find the value for A. We can eliminate 100 and 100 from both of the sides. In the next step, we can write 90A plus 75 into 30. I am not going to do any kind of raw calculation. So it will be 30 into 70 minus 75A equal to 30 into 70. You can still, you can find the relationship here, why I haven't actually done the raw calculation. So we can write 90A minus 70A as 15A. And we can write 30 into 78 minus 30 into 70. Fine, if I'm not wrong. And this can be written as 50A. We can take 30 common. Like I'm doing it in a long form, I can take 30 common. So we will get 78 minus. Actually, I have done a mistake here. This won't be 70. This will be 75. So be very careful. You should not do these mistakes in the final exam. So this is going to be your 75. This is going to be your 75. So this will be 30 into 70 minus 75. So this final is 15A equal to 30 into 3. This is 2 and A is 6 liter. So this is our final answer. This is option number B. Fine. Now, let us go to this last question. This last question doesn't require any kind of trick. It doesn't require any kind of logic and it does not require any kind of previous knowledge. What we need? We just need a simple formula. You have to remember this formula. Remember this formula, write down this formula, practice that formula, because this is the only way in which we can do this question. So their saying is that in a barrel of 729 milliliter of oil, n amount of oil is replaced by water. If the process continues for 6 times, find the amount of oil that will be left. Now, what they're doing is that we have 729 milliliter of crude oil. You are just taking out n amount of oil and replacing it by water. So the oil is continuously diluting out. So in this particular question, or in this particular types of question, we have to apply a formula. There is another type of question where we have wine and water question. In the wine and water question, what they do, we have wine and we take some amount of wine and then replace it water. And then we take some amount of that solution and replace with water. And then we take some amount of that solution and replace with water. Like we have wine. And then we take out N from here and we just, like we have taken N from here and then we add N here. And that is N of water. Fine. And then again, this process is successively repeated and repeated and repeated. So the formula is final quantity. Remember this, final quantity, write this down in your copy. Final quantity is initial quantity multiplied by 1 minus removal quantity or removed quantity divided by total quantity to the power number of times operation is performed. Number of operations. So what we have? We have final quantity. What is the initial quantity here? Initial quantity is 729 multiplied by 1 minus removal quantity, or the removed quantity is N. It is saying here that N amount of oil is removed. The total is 729 and this operation is repeated 6 times. So this is 6 times. So this is the final form only. There is no need for simplification, or there is no need for actually finding out an answer. I chose this question just so that I can introduce this particular formula to you. Remember this particular formula, because this kind of question can be only done using formula. When I'm saying can be only done using this formula, I mean that this is very hard to actually get on or find this relation, and it is going to waste a lot of time if you don't know this particular relation. So remember this formula. This is an important formula. So I hope I am done with today, and you can attempt the quiz for today's class also. You can go to www.campusprep.com and find the rest of the materials there. You can communicate, or you can contact me in the Telegram channel directly. Ask me your doubt, give me your feedback, and tell me if you have anything to add to the questions or not. You can visit our Facebook page. You can visit our Instagram page for regular updates. Thank you for watching our video. I hope that I could explain you all the questions that I have chosen. So it was a kind of a revision for numerical, as because we were doing logical for the past 1 or 2 weeks, 1.5 weeks. So we had done a lot of logical. So I thought that doing this kind of rapid revision for numerical will help you out to remember the topics that we have already learned. So that was it for today. On Monday, we are going to start with verbal. Verbal is just for verbal is very easy. We can complete it in one class. Then after the verbal is done, after the 10 classes, as per our schedule, in the 10 classes, we were going to complete our numerical and logical and verbal. After the 10 classes are done, the rest of the 5 classes I will dedicate for doing going through this programming part, going through the programming concepts and whatnot. So thank you for watching today. See you again on Monday. Bye-bye.